Welcome to the Dork Forest. Jackie and her pals will never bore us. Shameless confessions
about our obsessions
will make us laugh and smile. So let's explore the Dork Forest and dork out for a while.
Hello and welcome to the Dork Forest. This is Jackie Cation. I am your host of the Dork Forest. The website's JackieCation.com, DorkForest.com, TheDorkForest.com, FamilyPetAncestry.com, which leads you back to JackieCation.com. The credits are Mike Rickberg. He composed and sang the song you just heard at the beginning of the show. He will sing his words to the Mexican hat dance at the end of the program. Patrick Brady's going to fix this audio, and Vilmos fixes my website, JackieCation.com. There are many things to talk about. First and foremost, you should buy my new album. It's called I Am Not the Hero of This Story, and I Am Not the Hero of This Ad for my new album. It's pretty good. It's real fun. You can listen to it on Amazon and iTunes if you're some sort of membership. You can listen to it free on Spotify and Pandora and all the things. But you could also buy it on those platforms for download. You can buy a hard copy on my website on the merch page. And if you just want a download code and you're in another country, email me, Jackie@JackieCation.com. I will send you a picture of a download card with a code, and you could PayPal me $10. And that'll save you $10. Or you can just buy it for $10 from iTunes. Fascinating. Anyway, there are many ways to support the show. One of them is the Amazon banner at JackieCation.com or DorkForest.com. And all that is it's a portal to Amazon. If you order from Amazon, you use that portal from one of the websites. You order as normal, doesn't cost you extra, but the Dork Forest gets a kickback. Another way to do it would be to support the show directly with PayPal, with the PayPal button. You just PayPal me some money if you have money to donate, and I would appreciate that. Some people don't like PayPal. They've been donating via Venmo, and that is just by using my email address, Jackie@JackieCation.com. Other than that, you could get merch if you like stuff. I have two different Dork Forest t-shirts. There is a Ranger of the Dork Forest t-shirt, which is black. There is a green Dork Forest t-shirt with the logo. They're both American-made here in the United States, and they're union-made, so they run big because they're made here in America by Americans. You could also get any of my CDs, the new one and all the older ones, and also my DVD. This will make an excellent Horcrux. Everything's available digitally. You can even download the DVD over at comedyfilmnerds.com on their download page. This week, I am doing sets in Los Angeles. You can always find out where I'm performing at my calendar page on JackieCation.com. You can follow me on all of the social medias at JackieCation. And you can, there's a fan page for The Dork Forest and my stand-up on Facebook, facebook.com/TheDorkForest. Or there's a ranger page where you can interact with other rangers at, and I think it's just called Dork Forest Rangers. And other than that, The Dork Forest is part of an umbrella, a group of podcasts called allthingscomedy.com. And there's a bunch of other podcasts. If you're ever looking for podcasts, go over there and wander around. Other than that, I have another podcast over on Nerdist called The Jackie and Laurie Show, where we just talk a lot about stand-up comedy. But let's get into the show. Hey, it's Jackie Cation. I'm back in my living room, and I'm with a previous guest, friend of the show, Scott Rogers, Mighty Bedbug. How's it treating you?
Excellent.
Nope, your mic isn't on.
There we are. My
there
mic is on.
There, your mic is on. Hi, Scott Rogers.
Professional as always, yes. Hi, sorry about that. Yeah, hi, it's great to be here. I mean, I'm here a lot as it is, so it's...
You're around.
Yeah, and I'm around.
So you have made any number of board games that have been published.
No.
Actually, there's a
finite
number.
Actually, none. No? I've made no board games that have been published.
Okay, you've sold several board games that are going to be published.
No, I have not. Once again, no.
Oh,
no, I've made many video games that have been published.
Right, I think Andy's bragging you up.
He is bragging
me
up.
Without any sort of information, without all of the...
Andy is my best publicity agent. if you want to contact me,
right.
Through Andy Ashcraft.
You should totally. Yeah. It's Andy. Whatever.
No, I do have a few games that I'm talking to publishers with.
Okay.
But none of them are done deals except for this one.
This one, which is Ray Guns and Rocket Ships.
This is Ray Guns and Rocket Ships. And
you got a Kickstarter going for it.
April 19th, the Kickstarter starts. I think it goes for about 3 weeks, but quote me on that.
Okay,
so that goes till about May 10th or so, I believe.
Okay, and so what people should do is just go to Kickstarter, and there'll be a link. I'll put a link on the thing. and look for Ray Guns and Rocket Ships and Scott
now,
Rogers.
Yeah,
Scott
now,
Rogers.
Now it is going to eventually be commercially sold. It's coming out in the fall, but I don't have an actual date for that yet. But essentially, the Kickstarter, part of the reason why we're doing it, they're like, well, you know, why are you going to Kickstarter if it's already coming out?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the reasoning is this. Kickstarter is like the equivalent of buying television time. Mm. And, you know, there's no other real good way to advertise a board game out there.
And Kickstarter is huge for board games, right? That's,
yeah,
people
it is.
Love
the, it is the largest.
Like
yeah, it's the largest, like their best selling thing. Like the anything that funds really well, it's usually in board games and tabletop games.
Yeah. All sort of pen and paper, not video games, not...
Well, video games do pretty well, too, but the ones that have, like, crushed a lot of their big records were Exploding Kittens, which made, like, $8 million.
Wow.
And then there was, I don't know, there was another one that made, like, $3 million. I forget what that one was. But then Kingdom Death, which is, like, this crazy board game RPG game, made, like, $12 million.
Wow.
Yeah, which is...
And it's just people giving you 30 bucks at a pop saying, well, I would like a copy of this game.
In the case of Kingdom Death, it was, like, more like 300 to 1,000.
People were giving 300 to 1,000 to get a board game?
Well, the core board game is $200, which is pretty spendy. Well, Kingdom Death is it's an exception to the rule. They are like a boutique.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
They're like the Apple store of board games.
Okay.
It's this fascinating, this guy named Adam Poot. He lives in New York, and he makes miniatures. And he was like, oh, I want to make this game. And this game, like the first time he funded it, it made like about $1.5 million or $2 million.
Okay.
And they started getting really amazing reviews. And people are like, oh, my God, this is like the most amazing game ever.
What was the game?
It's called Kingdom Death Monster.
Okay.
And it is it's kind of like Descent, where you build like a – you have like a map of the environment, and you have these miniatures. And you're part of it is like a boss fight. So you fight – you wake up naked in the middle of this weird world where there's nothing but faces for the ground. Okay. And you have a lantern. And you're like, where the hell am I? And then all of a sudden, I don't know where this giant lion comes and tries to murder you. And so you have to fight. Where you like essentially pick up a rock off the ground and try to beat the lion to death.
And it's a video game?
No, it's a board game.
It's a board game?
Yeah, it's a board game.
What the fuck?
Yeah.
Now I do want to play this.
And
yeah,
and then, oh, don't worry, I'll be getting one in June. We'll play it.
All right.
But essentially, you fight the lion, and the big thing that everybody kind of is like shocked by is that you can like knock off different parts of the monsters you fight it. So you can knock off its arm, or you can knock off its nuts, or something like that.
Yeah.
And then you take those parts back to your little village. Right, so you've got lion parts, and you go back to your village, and where like a bunch of other survivors are kind of hanging out. They're survivors, but really they're just spare people because you die a lot in this game. Like essentially, they're extra lives.
Okay,
and so as you build your village, you use hey, we're gonna mash up these brains from this lion, and we're gonna use it as a paste, and that paste is a healing salve. So the next time we go out on a fight, we have some stuff we can heal as we're fighting, or gonna take the claws and we're gonna.
So you don't beat the boss. You just
gut it, like you use all the parts like the American Indians do. Right? And it's like, we're going to use the claws and the tail. And
to make armor.
Yeah,
and we're going to make...
Yeah, you make armor and you make weapons.
Healings.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. And so then you go back out and they're like, all right, now we're going to go kill this screaming antelope, which is like this antelope with its guts hanging open.
Right.
And it's weird and does all these weird attacks. And essentially...
So you keep going back and forth.
Yeah, there's
doing
more
that.
Monsters, but the monsters ramp, so there's difficulty levels. I mean, it really is like... His inspiration was video games.
Yeah.
And so like a lot of the really good mechanisms that you find in video games, he applied to this board game. So it's this very interesting. It's like a post video game board game, right? Like
nice.
Like you know how board games, they've been around forever. I mean, first of all, they've been around since like 9000 AD, right? Like backgammon and stuff like that.
Sure.
They're super old. But then there's like modern board games, and I'm using finger quotes,
yes,
like Monopoly and Life. And like those are still from
Don't forget about the shitty version of Parcheesi
of course.
That haunted our childhood.
But like Parcheesi, though, is super old, like chess, right?
Yeah.
Or checkers. But like then you had like Life and like –
Oh, Parcheesi is super old?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
so Monopoly and
Monopoly
Life
is like the turn of the 19th or 20th century.
Okay.
Right? So then we got all that crap we grew up with that was like roll and move, right? And garbage gameplay. So, and then in about the 80s –
No offense, if you
No, no offense, Hasbro, or USopoly, or whoever else makes Monopoly.
Yeah.
So then in the 80s or so, actually, it was Dungeons & Dragons was kind of like the big bomb that went off in tabletop gaming.
Yeah.
And so all of a sudden, everybody's like, hey, games can be about something other than World War II or Napoleonic Wars or abstract things moving around.
Yeah.
And so they started to apply theme to it, like more stories. And more than just light, like before it was all licensed stuff, like James Bond or Batman or...
Do you know what game I liked when I was a kid was this thing called Masterpiece?
Yeah.
And it was about...
Mastermind or Masterpiece?
It was an art...
Oh, yeah.
It was an art card game,
and
you'd get values for each of the art things, but some would be forgeries.
You know,
so it was whatever.
You know, it was one of the games I played when I was a kid?
Huh.
You ever play Authors?
No.
It was a lousy game. Essentially,
but
you
loved it?
No, well, it made me smarter, so I liked it.
Okay.
It was a card where on the front was a picture of Edgar Allan Poe.
Right.
And then on the back were, like, some of his famous works.
Okay.
And so you had to essentially guess... All right, name three books.
Oh, they were flashcards.
Yeah, they were flashcards, right? But it was disguised as a board game.
Right.
That was like the kind of crap that was out there when I was a kid. Although there were some other cool ones. Like my other favorite one was called Voice of the Mummy.
Okay.
Voice of the Mummy, you were a little Indiana Jones guy walking around the ziggurat.
Yeah.
And you'd pick up these gems. And in the middle was this mummy, but hidden underneath it was an old-timey record player.
Okay.
Like, you know, tiny ones? And so you would press it, and the mummy would be like, the voice of the mummy is going to destroy you, and if you touch my gem, you will burst into flames. Actually, it wasn't that cool, but you would like it essentially would like set you back.
But it was an actual tiny record player.
It was a little record player, right?
Yeah.
And it would have different tracks, and it would order boss you around, and you had to do what the voice of the mummy said.
Yep.
And if you didn't, you went back down to the bottom of the ziggurat, and everybody was sad.
Yeah, but it was a nice device.
Yeah, it was awesome. Technology.
You ever see Hamlet 2? Anyway, so Hamlet 2 was a time machine.
Gotcha.
Anyway, it's a
right.
bad movie. Anyway, I liked it, but it was terrible.
Write that down in notes.
Okay.
But the really thing that I like myself growing up on board games is I love the toy nature of board games.
Like, right, you like the toy value,
oh my God,
right?
Or, yes, absolutely.
So does this Kingdom Death Monster guy, does he have dudes?
Well, they're miniatures, yeah.
Yeah.
But they're these gorgeously made miniatures. Like, because now we're living in the age of 3D rendering, right?
Yeah.
So they make these models on computer, and they can detail them to the nth degree and make them beautiful.
And then just print the heck
out
of them,
Then they print them out, and the quality is like you get very little resolution loss. So if you go online and look at these figures, and then what's even better / worse about it is that they come unpainted.
Okay.
So, but then that means that really super talented people can paint them.
Yeah.
And there's painting miniatures. Like when I was a kid, it was like slap some red on, slap some skin on, slap some silver for the sword. All right. Hey, look, mom, look what a good job I did.
Yep.
But nowadays it's like it's an art form. And I know professional painters. And
yeah. I think Chris Mancini was talking about how with some Kickstarters that can be add-ons or something at the end of it.
We're not doing that for my game.
No, not for your game, but which is good because he said that's it. It feels a little it kind of irritates him, even though he ends up buying stuff. The add-ons, he's like he'll end up buying stuff, but he's like, why isn't it just part of the
part of the game?
Yeah, and then he said, and you can spend like $20 to have them painted, or you can spend like $1,000 to have them painted, and it's the difference between Michelangelo doing it and.
Right.
Me.
Yeah, yeah.
So ray guns and rocket ships, though, that has pretty good toy value, if I remember correctly,
it's got great
right?
toy value. Well, first of all, it's got here she's digging in the box.
Yeah, there's dudes.
So all the dudes are actually they come pre-colored.
Yeah.
Because one of the things I love vintage toys. I love vintage science fiction. I love
This has this 50s kind of
30s. 1936 is my year for ray guns and rocket ships.
Oh, is that it?
It's very much very much like. If it's 1936, that's my target.
Foam House of Tomorrow. Nice work.
well, even earlier. It's Flash Gordon. It's Buck Rogers.
Okay.
It's all the stuff that, like the stuff that inspired George Lucas to do Star Wars, right?
Right.
And
when you say inspire.
Well,
anyway.
Yeah. you can say inspire. but one of the other inspirations for me, there were some toys from the 50s that were made by a company called Mark's, and they had this whole great line called Space Patrol.
Yeah.
And Space Patrol were these little plastic spacemen and aliens. And they would reprint them over the years. And, I had army men and I had pirates. And every once in a while, I'd come across these little Space Patrol guys. I'm like, these guys are really cool too. So I can have space. And this was before Star Wars action figures, right? So I was playing Star Wars, but with Space Patrol guys.
Right. And did they just have those roundy helmet things?
They didn't have anything. They were just plastic dudes like army men.
Oh, they were like army men, but they were supposedly in space.
But they were space, and they were bright colors. So rather than being green, they were reds and purples and pinks and things like that.
Okay, brighter.
And so my guys in my game, one of the things that when I was working with my publisher, who's IDW Games, hi guys,
there you
I told them, it's really important for me to when you walk by and look at my game, that it looks like you're playing with a bunch of these figures from 1950s, you know, these Marx guys. So here I'm dumping out a whole bunch for Jackie to
look at. And there's a rocket.
And there's a rocket ship. And there are guys with ray guns.
And guys with backpacks and jetpacks.
Yep, jetpacks, yep. And then we have four different, in the game, there's four different, what I call factions. They're Planeteers.
the Planeteers. Yeah,
they're Planeteers. And there are four different factions of Planeteers. There are Astro Rangers. So these red guys.
Is this the rocket red guys or the Astro Rangers?
Yeah, those are the Astro Rangers.
And these Cthulhu squid dudes?
Yeah, so the monsters you're looking at, those are the Blarg. They are...
Not the Blarg.
Yeah, they're the Blarg.
The Blarg have come.
They're the they're like sentient brains on mechanical pants. and Cyclopean, of course. And have horrible mind powers. Then we have... Oh, this guy's a little... he's the Star Pirates.
They have swords.
Yeah, they've got swords. So you sword
and,
fight.
And a nice long coat.
Yeah, yeah.
Why wouldn't a...
Well, a cape. The captain wears the cape, right?
Captain wears a cape.
Yeah, although this captain has a crown, and then she doesn't have a cape. She's fast.
Excellent.
And then we have the fourth Planeteer faction are the Zard. I'm opening this up there.
Right, sure. And then there seems to be a fifth.
I'll talk about those in a second.
Yeah.
But the fourth one of the Zard, these are lizard guys, purple lizard guys.
Oh, slea stacks.
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah.
Or like lizard men from D&D.
And they got tails.
Yep, they got tails. They can whip with their tails, and they have claws. They can claw their way into the ship.
And they have their own ship.
Yep, they have their own ship. It looks kind of
So each set has their own kind of ship.
Yeah, yeah. So this
one kind of looks like a star. The squid dudes kind of look like, and that's not what they're called. What are they called?
The Blarg.
The Blarg. They have more of a Star Trek-y looking ship.
Yeah, they have a saucer.
Yeah.
So the gameplay, the way you play it, is that you've got a couple of different boards. You've got one board that you put in the middle. This is the star map.
Yep.
So here we have, we put our rocket ships on our star map.
Yep.
And we're going to use cards to fly these around. So if you've ever played, have you played Robo Rally yet?
Nope.
Okay, you should play that. It's fun. Robo Rally is this game where you program robots and you move them around this maze. You're trying to get out of the maze.
Okay.
I really like the way it made things move like a little unpredictable. So I wanted
the randomness.
Yeah, yeah. There's a randomness to it. So I wanted the spaceships to feel really big, almost like submarines or like pirate ships or something.
Okay.
And so I found that by having you program in movement. So essentially, you pick three cards, and these are the cards that you're going to use for the next few turns.
Oh.
So you program in, and you say, all right, I'm moving my ship forward. But of course, you could move your ship forward, and then we're like, now we're in range of each other. And the facing matters because it's like the guns are along the sides of the ship.
Right,
the advantage of the Blarg ship being a saucer, he can fire in a whole bunch of different directions, right?
Crazy Blargs.
So you line up your ships, and you fire, blast away at each other, and you do damage. And then you also have a little map that's the inside of your ship.
Okay, so with your dudes in it.
Yeah, so your dudes are on your ship inside. So you've got miniatures of your dudes on the inside of your ship. And you've got a miniature of your ship out in outer space. And you can run these guys around. And there's tokens that you can put down that are guns to give them better odds for shooting.
This is cool.
Thank you.
And you know what? Because Andy said that it is fun and he really likes this game. But I was like, I didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
And,
well, why would you?
Why would I? Because I haven't had a chance to sit around and play board.
You've been too busy working.
I've been working.
Dork Forest.
But the lucrative world of the Dork Forest. Don't forget to donate, folks.
Right, of course.
So what are the other ones?
Oh, so you've got these. So everybody's got a ship, right?
Everybody's got the internal.
So you
part
put
of
your
ship.
Ships, right? So you got your thing. Of course, you would do it on a slightly bigger table than this.
Sure. This one folds out. Did Andy tell you that we just bought a new coffee table that rises up and then folds out into a gaming table?
It's like being in space.
It was a deal too.
It's awesome.
He's pretty psyched about it.
Yeah, I'm sure. So you put your guys on it, and then there's different functions in the ship. So for example,
you can board other ships.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's the best part. So you get into the airlock here, and there's the crew have like tokens that you spend to give them different moves and things like that, right?
Right.
So you spend your token, and you get out of the ship, and now you're in outer space. And you use your jetpacks because that's why all these guys have jetpacks.
Yeah.
They fly around. You can move them around. But they can also fight in outer space, right? So here are fighting in zero G while these ships are shooting at each other. And then the best part, the part everybody likes, is you get next to the ship and if you make a successful attack, now I can come on the enemy ship and I can start fighting everybody inside their ship, and I can start busting stuff up. And like,
and you can kill them individually.
Oh, yeah, you can kill them individually. And essentially, you play until like a predetermined number of points.
Yep.
And then once somebody hits that number of points, you do one more round, so everybody gets a chance to kill each other.
And catch up.
Yeah, catch up. And then that's the end of the game. It's just a game about really pissed off space people wanting to kill each other.
Fantastic. And what's the blue team?
So the blue are the characters that we're going to have on Kickstarter. Now, I'm not 100% sure yet what they're – if they're going to just be exclusive or they're going to be what's called stretch goals. So stretch goals these incentives to get people –
Like if you hit a certain point, then everybody gets an extra set of dudes.
Exactly. It's like a telethon or something, right?
Yeah.
So these are mercenary captains because the game itself –
Mercenary captain has a hat with feathers in it.
Oh, we'll talk – oh, no, it's not feathers.
Well, those are not feathers?
He's a rabbit.
Oh, he is an actual rabbit.
He's an actual rabbit. Yes, he's a giant anthropomorphic rabbit. And we have a werewolf guy.
Excellent.
And we have a giant boxing robot.
Is that a boxing robot?
Yeah, he's the Battle and Box. He used to be the Galaxy's heavyweight champion, and now he's a mercenary captain.
He looks kind of like Frankenstein.
He does, a little like Rock'em Sock'em Robots, right?
Sure.
Or that kind of thing.
And
or a Robot Man, if you know the Doom Patrol.
Sure.
Right? A lot of my loves are poured into these characters.
Yeah, yeah.
All my influences.
And everybody, I mean, the thing is you've been on twice before, and your dorkdom's it is a diamond.
Oh, we haven't.
There is a facet.
We haven't gotten into anywhere near.
Yeah, anything.
So these characters will be most likely stretch goals. So as you people hopefully spend money on this, and
yeah,
I think the MSRP is going to be like $74.99.
But MSRP?
The cost of the game.
Oh, right. So if people donate $75.
I don't know if they're – it's probably that, and they'll probably throw in shipping. I don't know. Don't quote me on that yet because the thing hasn't started, and until the thing starts, that's exactly –
it's set in stone here, you guys. You're good.
Things are sometimes a little fast and loose in the board game world.
And the Kickstarter world because there's a – I mean, there's – What are there? Seven guys in each group?
Well, there's seven
– six guys in a ship.
There's six guys and a captain – the captain has special abilities. He's kind of like – they're kind of like the queen in chess.
And then you get a ship.
So there's eight miniatures per faction.
At least four factions.
Right. There are four factions to start out with. So you're going to get like 32
minis. So this is a $100 board game.
It's $74. It's not
right. It could be.
And if there's a lot of cardboard. There's tokens and there's also
there's card sets.
Yeah,
and
there's dice. You'll get four dice. And then there's also captain cards that have unique abilities on them. So
yeah.
And they're two-sided. So like if you're like, I'm going to play – let's see. I'll just grab one of these here. Where are they? In here somewhere? My fingernails are not working. But let's say we grab here we go. Count Ventura. He's the pirate captain. So you have one side.
Count Ventura.
Yeah, Count Ventura. He's the swashbuckling space captain pirate. Mm-hmm. And on one side, he is a really good gunner. So, like, he can fire cannons really well. But on the other side, he's a really good swordsman. So that way you can say, oh, I like the swordsman guy version better. Or, hey,
okay,
I played
so
the
ranged
sword one.
Attack versus
distance
hand-to-hand.
Attack, right?
Yeah.
So each of the captains have a two-sided card. So you can technically play this game eight times and get a different experience each time, which isn't bad. You know, how many times do you play a board game?
No, that's great. Now,
Then the mercenary guys are a whole nother single character.
Yeah.
And they come with their own cards as well. So if we hit all the stretch goals, there's I think another seven characters that are the mercenary captains.
And then
the other thing that I think she's going to be a Kickstarter exclusive, she's normally a token. We have a princess because of course you got to have a princess to rescue.
Fair enough. But, she should rescue herself.
That's the thing. She does actually. she starts out as a prisoner, but the minute you kind of like tag her, she all of a sudden becomes arguably the best character in the game. And she can do everything the crew members can do and more.
Well, how did she get into trouble? She went out looking for trouble.
She went out looking for trouble.
And she's going to take care of herself once she's no longer tied up.
Well, the other fun thing about we really have fallen in love with her. Princess Persephone is the character. And we've kind of fallen in love with her and to the point where we're like, we don't want her to just be this extra mechanism in the game. Let's give her her own character card. So she's also now a captain as well. And my favorite part about her is she's a little hoity-toity, and so fighting is beneath her. So she doesn't fight, but she's really good at telling everybody else what to do.
She delegates.
Yeah, she delegates, exactly.
Yeah, that's why you go into a leadership position.
Exactly. So she is a princess. She doesn't fight, but she, you know, right. she's gonna make sure that everybody does a good job and does it well.
Fair enough.
And all that. So that's kind of – and then the other thing the game is going to come with – are episodes. They are
little scenarios.
Like, so one scenario might be, hey, there's some secret plans that may or may not be for some sort of planet-killing device. You want to go into who's the one that holds them at the end of the game. They get extra points or something. So it's like capture the flag. Or, I mean, there are 10 different of these scenarios.
Sort of like a winning goal or something.
Yeah. But we have a lot of other pieces that aren't used in the – like if you were to just do the bread, meat and potatoes version of the game. It's the ships, it's the miniatures, it's the dice, it's the cards. But then
if you want to get fiddly as all hell,
we have asteroids, we have robots that you can salvage from outer space and use them. We have the data plan tapes. We have the princess. We have a bunch of other fun tokens and things like that. And then the last thing that's in there, kind of tying to my video game roots, is we have an achievement chart. So as you play the game, there are certain benefits that you can get depending on how you play the game, and people essentially fight over them. They're like, okay, you know, if you are the first guy to go into outer space, you get a benefit for that. But then the next time another player, it's their first time in outer space, they steal that benefit away from you. Right, so you're fighting. Not only are you fighting each other,
you get jaded.
Yeah.
Once you're out in space,
you know.
You're like, oh, I've been here.
Right.
It's like going to New York.
Right.
You're like,
once you've been
it.
There twice, three times, you know, it's all the same.
It.
Once you've eaten one Nathan's hot dog.
Andy bought a game that I've talked about on this show on other board game episodes that I genuinely like, and I've now played twice.
Which was?
It's called Black Fleet.
Oh yeah, I saw that. I saw him.
It was $7.
Right. Well,
and it was on sale. It was a hell of a deal. And what you do is you play a pirate ship.
Right.
You play a merchant ship.
Right.
And then there are two Navy ships that are communally played.
Nice.
And every turn, you move your pirate ship, you move your merchant ship, and you can move one of the two Navy ships to attack other people's.
That's a lot like the one where him and I are playing.
That Seafall thing?
Yeah, Seafall.
He said that Black Fleet, to some extent, is what Seafall should be, which is too bad.
All right, well, then we should play some Black Fleet.
And it's plus it's finite, which right. I'm a big fan of in the world of.
Yeah, you don't have to play a million times.
Yeah, I've decided the pandemic. We have Risk Legacy and Pandemic Legacy. I've made an executive decision that I'm unmoved at the Legacy games.
Now,
did
you play Risk Legacy?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Right. And I like the idea, but the scheduling commitment.
It's a big time commitment.
Yeah, and it's so much time commitment. I'm just like, I would rather just play Lord of the Rings Risk.
Right.
And then he also bought a Marvel Risk. He got it on sale.
Cool. Is that the Civil War one?
The Civil War
one. Oh, yeah, I have that too.
Have you played it yet?
No, yeah.
Yeah.
I love the mechanic where you're like racing to get something done before the plane takes off. It's got like on a runway or something.
It's essentially that scene in Civil War, the movie, that when we were watching the movie, Andy leaned over and he said, why is this fight happening? They've already
to make the video game and
possibly to make the board game and the video game happen. And it was hilarious.
He's worked on enough.
He does well. He saw it. He saw it.
He saw the behind the curtain. Once you see the little man behind the curtain, you can't unsee it.
You can't unsee so many things.
So anyway, so that's Reagans and Rocket Ships. It's coming out, like I said, on Kickstarter April 19th, and I'm super excited because it is my first published board game, and I have loved – well, there's two things I love about this. One is I love board games. I've always loved board games, and so I'm super excited because when I was working on all those other video games, and I've worked on a lot of kind of what they call AAA games like God of War and Pac-Man World and Darksiders and Maximo and blah, 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 blah. And I loved all those games. Don't get me wrong. They're awesome. But the minute the power goes out, you have the most expensive coaster you've ever bought, right? A $60 coaster.
Yeah, yeah.
And the physical part of board games is what I adore about it. I love moving little guys around. I love like games that you make little buildings or that you know, whatever. Like, and this is what a part of, not all of it, but a part of modern board gaming has in it is this tactile, you know, just toy factor.
Yeah.
And so myself as a game designer, I've kind of like, I think that's where my line in the sand is going to go is like, I want to just make cool games with cool, like if you look at them, you're like, oh my God, that looks like you're playing with, you know, little
toys.
Army men and toys. Yeah. And well, we kind of are, but we're.
Yeah,
the you know.
Andy keeps – he likes – clearly, there's a reason why you are friends because he likes the toy value of a lot of games as well. And but speaking of toys,
yes,
let us spend the last half hour
– we're going down this rabbit hole, are we?
Right. Well, I mean, the thing is you said that you collect Star Wars action figures.
Yeah, I do. So
have you always –
yes, I have.
From because we are of an age.
Yes.
I believe you are younger, but you saw Star Wars when it first came out.
Yeah, absolutely.
So did you get the toys then?
Like when you were like 9 or 10? Well, toys didn't exist back then. That's the thing.
There were no toys?
So in 1977, kind of Lucas knew that Star Wars was going to be super hot. And so he cut essentially the first best marketing deal ever cut in the history of marketing deals.
Right.
And he essentially said, I'll take a lower cost of other stuff, but I want like controlling profit for the toys.
Okay.
And everybody's like, okay, ha ha ha, George Lucas, sure, you can have all the toys you want.
Yeah.
But the thing was, George Lucas knew what he was doing.
Yeah.
And so he cut all these deals with Hasbro and, you know, everybody, right? He was marketing all over the place.
You know what else he did?
What did he do?
American Graffiti.
Oh, of course. Well, but he had learned from that.
He got the music rights to that.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
And then he cut in all the actors.
Yeah.
And so every year those guys get like crazy ass royalty checks.
Well, I've heard stories of like Mark Hamill saying every time they release a new Star Wars action figure, he gets like a case of them or something like that as part
right.
of his deal.
Oh, wow.
Right. So, yeah, Carrie Fisher, before she passed, she would tell stories about like she would just give away, you know, these mint, you know, things that are now worth thousands of dollars as like Halloween candy to, you know, how you want you want a mint on card Boba Fett? There you go. You know, whatever. Because what am I going to do with this? Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So anyway, so when I was a kid, I saw Star Wars and like everybody else of a certain age that was, you know, 8, 9, 10, whatever.
And alive.
And saw Star Wars. It blew my little lizard mind. And I knew that from that moment on, I wanted to do something Star Wars related. And the funny thing is, Ray Guns and Rocket Ship started as a video game concept.
Yep.
And it came about, I was having a conversation with my very dear friend, Hardy, who's also a video game designer. And he said, hey, you know, have you ever thought about what kind of game you would make if you could ever make whatever game you wanted? And I'm like, oh, man, I would love to make a Star Wars game. And Hardy is like, has not bought in all the corporate bullshit like everybody else has. And he just kind of scoffed at me and he went, dude, make your own goddamn Star Wars, right? Mm-hmm. And so I thought about it and it was like, it's probably one of the better pieces of advice I've ever gotten in my life.
Right.
And so I said, I'm going to make my own damn Star Wars. And so I made Ray Guns
and Rocket Ships
as a pitch for a video game.
Right.
And I pitched it, but everybody was like, this is too complex. We can't make this right now. I'll bet you could make it now.
Yeah.
But back, back when I first pitched it, they were like, it's too big. Well, it's too seamless because I wanted to go from a spaceship to outer space, back into another ship, down to a planet, down to blah, blah, blah. Right.
Yeah.
And so they were like, we can't do that. Like No Man's Sky is kind of the first game that's done that.
Yep.
And even then the gameplay is like, they should have scaled it back instead of making it this huge universe. But anywho, so Ray Guns and Rocket Ship started out as me kind of thinking about all the things I loved about Star Wars and saying, how can I put this into a game?
Right.
Now that said, when I was a kid, I was just like everybody else, I was starving for Star Wars stuff and there was nothing out there. There was like a few things here and there. But in 1970, so Hasbro, who had the license, they screwed up. They were like, we had no idea this movie was going to be so big, but they had the license. And so they had to, at Christmas time, issue essentially like IOUs to kids to kind of say, here's if you buy this envelope full of stickers and this little cardboard thing that you can stand up with pictures of Star Wars guys on it. Because remember, Star Wars wasn't everywhere. And so as a kid, anything that had Star Wars on it, we were like, we don't care if it's a piece of cardboard, we'll take it.
Right, with a sticker on it. Yeah,
we'll take
it,
man. It's Star Wars. I can just stare at it and because I love Star Wars so much. And the first thing I did when I saw Star Wars was I ran home and started to draw cardboard, like paper dolls of the characters because I wanted action figures so badly from them.
Yeah.
So finally, the figures came out. They issued this thing called an early bird set, which was a set of Luke, Leia, Chewie, and R2 action figures. But they pre-sold these cardboard envelopes and they weren't delivering the figures till like spring. So essentially it was an IOU.
Right.
And it was this brilliant thing that all these parents were like, well, my kid loves Star Wars and he's got to have something Star Wars under the tree. So I'll buy this thing because eventually –
And then 4 months later,
you'll get these figures, right?
Huh.
So I didn't even know about this. My parents for some reason just didn't key into this. So 4 months later, the stores start getting toys and that's when I found them in spring of 1978.
Okay.
Right around Easter time. And I remember I walked into my mom's car had died. She had this real lemon of a car and it had died for the umpteenth time. And so we were fortunately like two blocks away from the mechanic was two blocks away from the toy store. So my mom's like, come on, let's go look at the toy store. And I walk in and all of a sudden there's this store that's like filled to the gills with Star Wars action figures I'd never seen before.
Wow.
Because remember, no internet, right? We didn't know
internet.
This stuff was coming.
77.
And I looked and I'm like, oh my God, I want them all. And my mom's like, well, we're not getting them all, but you can get two of them.
Two.
And so I agonized because there were 12 figures that were released at first. And I was like, well, I love Darth Vader, so I got to get Darth Vader. And then I'm like, well, who do I get? And I'm like, but, you know, Luke, it was Luke dressed as a farm boy, and he didn't interact, Vader didn't interact really with Luke in the movie. So I said, well, I guess I'll get Obi-Wan Kenobi because he actually sword fought with Darth Vader.
Oh, right. And you could play with him.
Yeah. So I could play with him too. And my brother bought like Chewbacca and Han Solo. I'm like, don't you want a stormtrooper to shoot at? He's like, nope. I just want the two of them to hang out.
Yeah.
So, anyway, so those were my first two action figures.
Yeah.
So I ended up getting pretty much all of them. Like every Christmas and birthday, I would just say, all I want is Star Wars action figures.
Yeah.
That or Dungeons and Dragons. Those were the only two things that I wanted as gifts. And then when I grew up, I ended up actually near the tail end of the figures. There's like 90 some odd or 100 some odd figures in the series. Near the end of it, Return of the Jedi had kind of come and gone, and I was in high school, and I'm like, ugh, I'm like not a kid anymore. What do I need toys for?
Yeah.
But my mom is like super compulsive collector person.
Yeah.
And she was like, well, you got to finish the collection. So she bought the last ones for me.
Nice work.
Yeah. And to this day, I'm like,
well played, Mrs. Rogers.
Yeah. Thank you, mom. Mm-hmm. Because she's now I have a complete, almost a complete collection of the original figures.
Right.
Because thanks to my mom. Now there's one figure I'm missing, and his name is Yak Face, but he was only available in Europe. And there's certain figures Yak Face. He was like one of the guys in Jabba's Palace. He looked like Joe Camel.
Let me tell you something about these action figures and the fact that you know the names of all of them. Is that whenever anybody, because I think I was watching something and I made some comment about, I was watching Star Wars. I was watching A New Hope.
Right.
And
good for you.
Good for me. and I was live tweeting it for some reason.
Oh, that's awesome.
I was alone. And so I was talking about R2, C-3PO talking to the other C-3PO.
Yeah, right.
And I was like, so he's talking to the silver C-3PO.
Right.
And I got a row of people telling me what that character's name was.
Yeah, all these characters have been...
They've been named.
Well, they've not been named.
Because of action figures,
well,
though,
not
only,
just that.
Right?
The role-playing game actually was the big reason why a lot of this stuff... So the role-playing game, they would come out with these source books. And so it's like, here is the cantina on Tatooine. And so you walk in the cantina and it's like, all right, there's that guy that looks like a snail. And there's that guy that looks like a Dracula. And there's a guy that looks like a devil and blah, blah, blah. But now these game designers, there's like, well, we're making this source book. And so you want to know who all these guys are. And then they start making up backstories for them, right? So now, but the problem is this. I don't remember who all the guys that made those things are, but they pretty much had two tricks up their sleeve. Either they were a rebel or an imperial spy,
okay,
or they were a bounty hunter. That was it. those are like the only occupations.
Was a bar.
Those are the only occupations. And so for me, I'm like
nobody's an accountant just coming in for a beer.
Well, can't just somebody be a drunk? Like there are no just like why can't Greedo, the guy who shoots, you know, why can't he just be a drunk? Right. Or like some scumbag that happens to know Jabba the Hutt. And he's like, oh, I know Jabba the Hutt wants this guy dead. So maybe I'll try and capitalize on this. Right.
But
he comes from a whole race of bounty hunters and it's just like, oh, for God's sake, it's the stupidest garbage.
Well, but it's also like it's when people talk about reincarnation, no one's ever reincarnated.
Oh,
from,
right.
Like,
they're always famous people.
Right. It's always Cleopatra.
Napoleon has been reincarnated like 1,000 times. Right. 1,000 people.
Right. But taller.
Right. Exactly.
Anyway. But
So
do you know their names from the action figures, though, or do you know them from the role play?
I prefer the action figure names. Now, the action figure names are arguably a little more insensitive. So, for example, you have Warris Man, who is the guy in the bar that comes up to Luke and like pushes him around and then gets his arm cut off.
Right.
Obi-Wan Kenobi. In the role-playing game, his name is like Pondo Baba.
But to be honest, named it.
Yeah, they named a guy. But to be honest, to me, you don't look like a Pablo Baba to me, right? That sounds like something you'd order at the Indian restaurant.
Okay.
It's not a
So Walrus Man is just
That was the nickname that the guys on the set gave the character.
Oh, because that's how what his makeup looked like.
Right, yeah.
Okay.
And there was a Snaggletooth, so that guy had a Snaggletooth. And
right.
Hammerhead, that guy had a Hammerhead. And, you know, Cancer, I think one was like the Terminal Man because he looked like he had cancer.
Right, and the insensitivity of these action figures are because Because people actually have cancer?
The guys in the 70s were just joking around and said, that guy looks like he's dying of cancer, so we'll call him the Terminal Man.
I'm all right with that. It's fine.
But to me, because I grew up on the action figures, and I also grew up on they still have these art books of the movies.
Right.
And in the movies, they have like the pre-production artwork, and they say, Greedo was known as the Martian for a while, right?
Right.
So he didn't have a name. He was just a Martian.
Okay.
So in my head, I think of Greedo as he's the Martian.
Okay.
So this is what I grew up on. And then the role playing stuff didn't happen until like the 90s.
Okay.
So I'm already in college or beyond by the time
Was there like 10 years when you didn't buy action figures or no?
So the thing is this, it wasn't that I didn't buy action figures, it's that they just weren't really there. So there's a period from about 1985 or 6 to 93 or 4.
Right.
Sorry. 95 or 6 is when they redid the Star Wars figures. So so Kenner was the company that owned, they got bought up by Hasbro. And Hasbro, they were like, hey, we should make Star Wars action figures again. And so in 96, I think it was, or 95, they essentially relaunched the line, but they modernized the figures. So if you look at the characters from that 96 lineup, it's called Power of the Force, they're much more the aesthetic at the time. This was when Todd McFarlane, the comic book guy, was making – he had just started his company, and all his toy characters that he made were like all super ripped and muscular. And so the characters, the Star Wars characters that they remade, like Luke is like, he looks like He-Man. His shirt's open. He's got all these, you know
– like pecs.
Got pecs and definition and all that. So when they first kind of came out, I'm like, well, I'm happy to see new Star Wars figures, but really? This is lame. Yeah, they were kind of lame. But I couldn't help myself. I still was like, I love action figures. I love toys. So I started to get them. But as the series went on, they started to redo them. So like Luke, you know, they slimmed him down and made him look more like Mark Hamill. And of course they were making these guys know how to speaking of American Indians, boiling every inch of a thing. I own a bazillion of these things. And I can now replicate every scene in the movie in action figure form of the major characters. I can go, Luke Skywalker wearing this costume specific thing. And then like if he takes off his coat, now I've got the version of him with this coat on. And then if he puts on his hat, I've got the version of that. Right. It's ridiculous.
Excellent.
But I can't help it. I love them. They're fun. I've played with them with my kids. The best thing that we ever do is we set them all up on, and then we take out the Nerf guns and try and shoot them all down.
Right.
I get a lot of mileage out of them. I still have ones that I collect. But to be honest, I've been starting to sell them off and thin out my, you know, they're taking up space. So.
Right. I mean, it's finite. The amount of space that the world has.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
So what about when the prequels came out?
Oh, well, yeah, unfortunately.
Did you buy in on those two?
I did. So when the first ones came out.
Darth Maul one was cool.
Yeah, it was cool. And the one that you could cut in half, there was a Darth Maul you could cut in half. That was pretty funny.
Yeah?
Yeah,
that's
fun.
Awesome.
And a Jar Jar that had a tongue that you could wiggle around.
Okay.
But I very quickly was like, well, these characters aren't very exciting looking. They're kind of...
Well, it's because the script wasn't.
Well, but even the character design, it was a lot of guys in robes.
Okay.
You know, and so I'm like, well, maybe it'd get better for the second one. So the second one came out, and I'm like, okay, well, there's a little bit more interesting characters. You've got kind of that Boba Fett knockoff, and you've got the clone army and that. But that movie was, like, bad. I mean, I came out of that movie feeling like somebody had kicked me in the head. I was like, what
happened? Yeah, I never even saw the third one because I couldn't face it.
Well, the third one is good.
That's what I heard. The third was the best of the lot.
Yeah, it was.
But I was like, well, it's fine.
But by that point, I had all these other action figures of characters that I just didn't give a crap about.
Yeah.
And so what I ended up doing was there's a guy that runs an event at the Star Wars Celebrations, the big convention for Star Wars that they have every so many years. And he does this great thing where they build these dioramas. Like they'll build the Death Star, they'll build Cloud City or what Jabba's Palace. And so what I did was I donated figures to him, just like boxes of these things.
Throw these away.
Well, no. Essentially,
but he doesn't.
No, he gives them to the people at the show, and then they use them
to fulfill their...
Yeah, to set them up in the scenes and all that. So I've donated hundreds of figures to these, literally hundreds of figures to these. So if you've gone to one of these celebrations in the past, odds are you probably have one
you've
of my
You've seen a Scott Rogers...
I didn't mark him or anything. There's no way to tell. But
nothing written on the foot like Andy?
No. Toy Story. But so the worst part is this. The figures, the original Star Wars figures were 3 3/4 scale, 3 inches and 3 3 and 3/4 inches tall.
Okay.
Right? So they're pretty tiny.
Yeah.
And so recently, within the past 5 or 6 years, there had been for a very long time a call for bigger scale action figures.
More now, like they'd always, original G.I. Joe kinds?
Well,
like
the, even bigger than that.
The 12-inch ones? Inch,
well, they'd made 12-inch ones. They'd okay. They've been making those for almost as long as they've been making the 3 3/4 guys.
Okay.
But the fans, the Todd McFarlane influence, he really pioneered like a 6-inch scale figure.
Sort of like that size?
Yeah,
more
yeah,
like the
exactly
Spider-Man?
That size. Okay. Yeah, we're looking at a Toy Biz Spider-Man.
Okay.
Or maybe even a, it's a Toy Biz one or whatever.
I don't know what it is.
Anyway. So that 6-inch scale is very popular with the collectors. And so they were like, we want Star Wars. But they were like, but if we make it this big, A, it's a whole – you're essentially going to be buying them all over again. And B, you could never put them in vehicles because the vehicles would have to be like the size of your furniture, you know, if they were 6 inches tall. And X-Wing is now, you know, it's like half the size of your living room.
Right.
So they kind of resisted. And finally, they were like, screw it. These idiots are going to pay for it. We're going to make them.
Right.
And so they started making this series called Star Wars Black, which is a 6-inch line of Star Wars figures. And they just started making new characters. Now, but when that came out, I'm like, ugh, I can't do this. I'm a 3 3/4 man through and through. I've got hundreds of these. I can't bail out on that format now. Right. So I said to myself.
Even though you buy the white album in every new format, every time.
Yeah. Well, no, I'm like that with Star Wars, right? Okay. I bought it on DVD and I bought, you know, the soundtrack. I always bought every format. It's stupid.
Yeah.
Anyway, so when the Black series came out, they were starting to make. They made like Han Solo and R2-D2 and Luke and that. And I'm like, all right, I'm not going to go all in on the Black.
You're just going to get the core.
Well, no. Well, yeah, the core, the original 12, the ones that were
right?
The original 12 are like.
Not the original 4, the original 12.
No, the original 12. Well, so okay. The original 12.
Who are the original 12?
They're Luke, in his Tatooine costume, Leia in her white suit. Han Solo in his vest, Chewbacca, C-3PO, R2-D2, Obi-Wan Kenobi, and then Darth Vader, a stormtrooper, the Tusken Raider, the sand person, the Jawa, and for some reason, my favorite character of all, the Death Squad Commander, who essentially are those Imperial Navy guys that have like the anti-aircraft helmets.
But the pointier kind of black?
They're like the guys that operated the Death Star, the cannon for the Death Star. They look like normal dudes, but they look like Nazis, right?
Oh, and okay, sort of. But it was like
They're like just
like an SS uniform.
Yeah, they look like kind of like SS guys, but with anti-aircraft helmets.
Okay,
so that was like those were the original 12.
So
figures.
One of those guys is one of the original 12.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, because they had a lot of stormtroopers and Darth Vader.
Yeah,
like, well, who else are we gonna make? We do want to make the old Peter Cushing. Nobody's gonna buy old Peter Cushing, and they never did. They never had made Peter Cushing in that original set.
Okay,
people were like, we want Peter Cushing, but
Peter Cushing?
But eventually they made him, and they've made him a few times over now.
Yeah, now they've.
So I don't worry, I'm good. I have a Peter Cushing.
Yes.
But anyway, so when the Star Wars Black came out, I'm like, all right, I'm going to get the original 12, and that's it. I'm going to call it a day. But the problem was this. They didn't release all – like, it was looking like they were never going to release Obi-Wan Kenobi. They hadn't released a Jawa. The Tusken Raider hadn't come out. And I'm like, oh, my God. It's been, like, 5 years. And the other thing was the Vader that they put out, I don't know who sculpted it. I apologize to in advance. But it looked like it was sculpted by a monkey. Because remember, like, when that lady repainted that painting of Christ?
Yeah.
Or whatever, and made it look kind of like that weird monkey thing.
Nope.
You never saw that? You never heard about that?
I was thinking of the guy from Winds of War who was in the Holocaust. whatever.
Anyway, so the Vader's, the sculpt, even though they've sculpted Darth Vader a million times, whoever they got to do that just did it, or whoever approved it, did a really bad job. And I saw that Vader, and I was holding him in my hand in Target, and I was looking at him, a $20 action figure, and I'm like, I cannot do it. I cannot bring myself to buy. This is the dumbest looking. I have a million other Darth Vaders. They all look way better than this. And this is the straw that broke my back. I could not. So I ended up taking all my action figures.
All the 6 inches?
Well, yeah, all the 6 inches. And I sold it to this other guy who wanted them. And so, I sold them for what I paid for them. And so he got a good deal. And I'm like, that's it. I'm not going to buy these 6-inch figures. This is just not for me.
Right.
But here's the worst part. The worst part is this. Now, so 2017 is the 40th anniversary of Star Wars.
Okay.
Right? And Hasbro, in their brilliance, of course, has reissued these figures.
Right.
But now, they have fixed all the problems. So Darth Vader has a gorgeous helmet now.
Yeah.
And Princess Leia doesn't look like a monkey anymore. She looks like kind of sort of like Princess Leia.
Okay.
But then what they did was they put them on replicas of the original cards. the old Kenner cards I grew up with. So now I'm like,
oh, so you're kind of in. Yeah, you're back.
And here's the best, worst part.
Right.
They're mostly only making the original 12 figures, which are the ones that I wanted.
Right.
So now I'm like, all right, you have just, you made up for what you screwed up on the first time. All right. Unfortunately, now I'm buying them. So now I've already found a few of them. They've just come out.
Right.
But there's still some that are hard to find because when they ship toys, they only have so much room in a box.
Right.
And so they do what's called short packing, which is some characters they put two of in a box and some figures they put only one of. So right now, the assortment is two Lukes, two Leias, two Obi-Wan Kenobis, one Han Solo, and one R2-D2. And the other worst part about it is R2-D2.
The fact that you know how they're packed.
Well, that's...
Welcome to the Dork Forest, Rangers. Yeah, I'm here with Scott Rogers, you guys, at Mighty Bedbug on Twitter.
Yes. Yeah, so the other worst thing about it is the R2-D2 was a really hard figure to find the first time around.
Yeah.
And so he goes, the Black Series one goes for like $100 online.
Okay.
And I owned him, and I was like, hey, I got one. But then I sold it to that guy.
Right.
So now I'm like,
had a Cal Ripken rookie card.
Yeah, exactly. We all have regrets.
Yeah, we all got regrets.
but anyway, so now I'm like, now I got to hunt and try and find R2-D2, and I got to find Han Solo. Right. And I'm sure they'll be everywhere. My unofficial motto is, eventually Star Wars is findable. Like they make so much of this stuff. It's not this. There aren't things so rare, particularly when you're making $20 plastic toys.
Yes.
There's going to be so many of them that it's not going to be hard to find.
You'll be able to figure it out.
I'll get them. I'll eventually get them. But the problem is I vibrate at high speed until I have them. And I'm like, want. And I'm always, this is my struggle. I'm always crushing that want down because otherwise I drive myself insane.
What about a Force Awakens and the
I did buy Force Awakens, guys. Rogue One, guys.
Rogue One.
But they're 3 3/4, so they're
oh, they are.
Scale,
so you're back to...
Well, they also made 6-inchers of them, the black. But no, I have my little... So the other thing I buy is the vinyl cases. So when the figures first came out back in the 70s, they made these really cool vinyl cases that you could store your figures in. And
like the foam that's cut out to look like a dude?
You know, vinyl, right? But then it's like a hard plastic container. And you put your figures in it and you close it up and it snaps shut. And it more or less keeps your stuff in line, right? The stuff doesn't go sliding around too badly.
Okay.
So they, for some reason, Hasbro, in their infinite wisdom, has decided to never make a good container to store your figures in. And so what I've ended up doing is I find like nice versions, like clean, nice versions that people are selling of these old cases.
Yeah.
And I kind of don't even care about the old vintage figures as much anymore.
Yeah.
I'm more interested in the cases because then I can use the cases to put all my new guys in. So
right.
I have about 35 or so of these cases filled with Star Wars action figures.
Wow.
Like the new guys. So if you go into
how many fit in a case?
About
maybe 10?
No, more than that. You can get about, I don't know, like 16 or so.
So are they shallow? That's why they don't rattle around so much?
Yeah,
or?
Yeah. There's two levels of them. So you get two trays.
Two trays
and
that can stack.
Yeah, and the fun thing is that if you take the tray out, they've got little pegs on them so you can actually put the figures. They have holes. The figures have holes in their feet.
In the base.
So that you can stand. Yeah, so you can stand them up and make like a nice little display of your guys all standing around doing nothing. And and so I've got, you know, and of course they're all organized by thematically. So I've got my box of Luke's, I've got my box of Han Solo's, I've got my box of Darth Vader and Stormtroopers.
By character, not by scene.
Well, kind of by movie a little bit. Like I have Hoth guys all together, like Snowtroopers and Rebel Snowtroopers. But then I have like all the Rebel leaders from Return of the Jedi and they're in their box.
What about vehicles?
Vehicles. So here's the thing. Vehicles are awesome. I don't have room for them in my house.
Right.
So I have some that are like mint in package that are like
you committed to a couple of vehicles.
Yeah. The vintage is the bane of my collecting existence because I love them. They're great, but they just take up way too much room.
Yeah.
I have a Millennium Falcon that is, no lie, almost as big as your couch.
Okay.
That you could open up and put stuff like the character, and it's like
right.
this beautiful, perfect replica of the ship from the movie.
Right.
But I have no room for it anywhere in my house, and so it lives in a very big box in a very big storage unit that I'm paying every month to.
To just keep,
which is horrible.
That is horrible.
Which my wife, I'm sure, does not appreciate.
Right. Right. But at least you're not hiding it.
No, that's true.
I have a Death Star.
Yeah.
And a Millennium Falcon that both came in a Darth by Chocolate and some sort of the light.
Just be careful you don't eat them.
They were they came in the new Star Wars at Disneyland.
Oh, right.
At the concession stand.
Oh, yeah. There's fun stuff
at
Disneyland.
The, the concession stand has a Darth White chocolate that came with a Death Star. And I forget what the light version.
The light side.
Yeah, the light side was. Because, by the way, it didn't taste as good.
No.
More proof that people like villains more.
Yeah.
It's really annoying. But the Millennium Falcon, and it lights up and it changes colors and it's pretty awesome.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there are a bazillion. You know, we will. I think when the world is destroyed, humanity is gone, and the aliens come down, they will think that we were populated by Star Wars action figures and not actual human beings.
Certainly near your house.
Yeah, Warris Mans and Greedos lived on Earth, not human beings.
Yes.
Because right? there are arguably more of those out in existence than there maybe are human beings.
Right. So Force Awakens and Rogue One, do they have old Han Solo and do they have old Leia?
Yeah, they got old Han Solo, old Leia, and I'm sure they'll do old Luke. And I mean, they haven't done old Luke yet, but
right,
they will.
Just had the last scene.
Right, yeah, but that doesn't stop
Spoiler
them.
Alert, guys.
That doesn't stop them.
Right.
Showing up for 2 seconds in a film does not stop the Hasbro company from making action figures.
No.
And to be honest, though, that's part of the fun.
Yeah.
Part of the fun is that, like, one of the cool figures that they made was there's a character from Empire Strikes Back. So the next time you watch Star Wars again.
Yep.
And you live tweet about it.
Yep.
There is a part where Lando Calrissian, Billy Dee Williams says, hey, everybody get out of the Cloud City.
Oh, right.
And so everybody just starts bailing, right?
Right.
And there's this one dude who, well, we can't call him, I call him Space African because there's no such thing as African American outer space. Right.
Right.
But he's a black guy. Yeah. That's holding essentially what it is it's some sort of machine. And he just he's hauling ass down the hallway.
Right.
And fans over the years have, like, when they watched the movie, they froze frame and they said, hey, that guy is holding a vintage ice cream churner, like an electric ice cream churner.
Yeah.
Like they figured out what the actual item was.
Oh, what the prop was?
Yeah, what the prop was. Because it looked like spacey enough to look like it.
They're like, it's an ice cream maker.
It's an ice cream maker.
Just carry it.
So he's now he has a name and his name is Wilro Hood and they call him essentially the ice cream man. And his backstory
awesome.
Is that he was the ice cream maker on Bespin and his special flavor was Bespin Berry Crunch or something like
sure,
that.
Sure. Why wouldn't it be?
And so for whenever Hasbro would say, well, who's an action figure that you want to see made? Everybody was like, Wilro Hood, we want the ice cream man.
We want the ice cream man.
And so eventually, to their credit, they made the action figure of the ice cream man.
Oh, my God.
So there's all types of crazy characters in the background that are action figures.
Right.
And that's part of the fun, though, is that you can then make
you can recreate
You can recreate the
You can
scene,
reshoot so. The movie.
Yeah, we'll have
which
people
Which people have, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
It's didn't people fix Phantom Menace? I think with action figures?
Probably. I'm sure that I'm sure it's out there somewhere.
Why wouldn't they?
Why wouldn't they?
Because there's trouble there, folks. and then what about Rogue One?
I really love the movie. So
spoiler alert on the movie. It's like watching All Quiet on the Western Front.
Spoiler alert. It's awesome.
It's awesome. It is awesome.
Yeah, it was great. I felt like a kid again.
Is it out yet?
Rogue One?
Yeah.
On DVD?
DVD?
Yeah, it just came out like this week.
Oh, okay.
So yeah,
this is April.
When I watched this movie, I was like, literally, my wife was mocking me later because she said, like every 5 minutes, I was like, what? this character? What? Grand Moff Tarkin? What? Actually, the funniest thing in it was, I'm a little embarrassed, but there's a scene where they showed Darth Vader's castle. Remember they showed that he's on that – it's on that lava planet, right?
Okay.
Remember that? So you saw the movie, right?
Yeah. I don't remember Darth Vader's castle.
Darth Vader is
– I've seen it twice.
Right. Okay. So there's a scene where Darth Vader's at his castle. He's in like the back to tank. He's getting pulled out and then the guy in white I forget who the actor is, but he comes up and says, hey, Darth Vader, you know, help me out here. And Darth Vader chokes him and makes fun of him and leaves, right?
Yeah.
But when they showed Darth Vader's castle – so here's the thing about Darth Vader's castle. When I was a kid, like 9 years old, I had this Art of Star Wars book. And in the early version of Star Wars, Darth Vader had this castle and there's like – they wrote all this stuff in this Art of Star Wars book about we were going to have a scene with Darth Vader at his castle and it was going to be guarded by these special guards and it was on this lava planet and it was going to be really awesome. And there were like maybe 2 or 3 drawings of like Darth Vader's castle. So
this is 3 pages in an art book from 1979
or 80 or somewhere around there, right? And this idea of like Darth Vader having this castle, kind of like being Dracula or something, has like lived in my imagination for almost 40 years. And when I saw Darth Vader's castle, I lost. I am a I am a 48-year-old man, and I lost my shit. I was like grabbing
castle.
My wife. I was grabbing my wife and going, Darth Vader's castle, Darth Vader's castle, and she was just like mocking me. And,
fantastic.
But it was finally
the dream comes true.
Oh my god, it was such a.
I don't think you're the only 48-year-old man. It turns out.
Oh, I'm sure there were plenty of other 48-year-old men.
I think that
doing
that's what.
That
no,
well.
No. I think those two guys created that castle.
Yeah, we're also very excited. Well, unfortunately, one of them is no longer with us. That was Ralph McQuarrie, the guy who did all the concept art for.
Oh, right. Right.
But yeah, I mean, that movie for me was like, you know, I know people say, oh, it was nothing but a big nostalgia. You know, you were just preying on people's nostalgia and stuff
like
that.
What, Rogue One?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Fuck those people.
Yeah, that's what I say.
Yeah, it was a great movie.
It was a great movie.
Just as a movie.
Yeah.
It was sort of like, you know, they say that all the different Marvel movies have different genres whatever. Rogue One was just a war movie, and it was amazing.
A war movie about Star Wars? Wait, what?
We all win.
Well, for me, I have been waiting for Rogue One. I think it's not my favorite. I still love the original Star Wars. I still love Empire.
Yeah.
But it's really close up there for me as, like, you know, the top spot.
Yeah.
Because it's everything I wanted to see in a Star Wars movie, which is I wanted to see Star Wars. I wanted to see a war in the stars, you know, and to be honest, for me, even though I love Darth Vader, the Jedi are the least interesting thing for me in Star Wars. I really don't care about the Jedi. They're kind of boring and dumb, and I love swords, but that's about the only thing I like about the Jedi. Everything else I can give or take.
Well,
I mean, the space wizard thing, okay, whatever, but
I like space swords. I like space wizards.
Right.
I'm good, but I like.
But when I saw the Attack of the Clones with like a bazillion of them running at each other, I'm like,
too many.
Too many.
Too many.
Yeah, and Yoda hopping around still annoys me to this day.
Yeah, yeah. That he might as well be Legolas riding on the backs of elephants.
Well, or, yeah.
Anyway,
or
Abraham Lincoln on the backs of horses.
Exactly.
I don't know if you saw Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter.
No, I still have not seen
it. It was really good. Historically inaccurate because he doesn't come to abolition actually until he was an adult.
It's going on
anyway,
Netflix.
So, no, you're not missing a whole lot.
Well,
but I enjoyed it. But the, what was the, but Firefly for me was Han Solo, the TV show.
Right, right.
And so I loved that so much. So Rogue One for me was such a, it felt like almost like, part of the same universe,
I'm very nervous about it, but I'm still looking forward to the Han Solo movie.
Oh, it could be.
It could. Well, the thing.
What is it? A slice of life in Han Solo, the young man?
They say it's like 6 years of his life. But the thing is.
So it's young Indiana Jones?
Yeah, which didn't go off very well for
me. Nope.
And to be honest, I don't mind seeing like an adventure of Han. Like I love the bit in Force Awakens where they're on the ship and he like had those horrible monsters and the two gangs were saying, hey, you owe us all this money. And they're like, whoops.
No, those two scenes are great.
Yeah. Yeah. That's like my favorite scene in Force Awakens is when he's on that ship because I'm like, I want to see a movie of this. I want to just see Han Solo being a smart ass and smarmy and kind of conning his way through life.
Right.
And a bunch
failing
of
failing and then for some reason not being killed.
Exactly. And like a bunch of weird alien or, you know, criminal types, all, you know, him interacting with all these things, right? That's what I want to see in this movie. So when they said Han Solo movie, on one hand, I was like, if it's like this, cool, I'm in. But the thing is, I'm starting to hear little things here and there that make me nervous. And the thing that makes me the most nervous is when the president of Disney, Bob Iger, says, well, we're going to learn how Han Solo got his name.
No.
And yeah, exactly. No, I don't want his name not to be Han Solo. I don't want him to be like Norbert, you know.
Yeah, I don't need to know that Stacy Leach changed his name to Cary Grant.
Yeah, exactly, right?
I think it was Archibald.
Yeah,
Leach.
and so now I'm nervous.
Yeah.
Even though the casting looks good and it could
Who's playing young Han Solo?
Some guy.
Some guy who looks
kind of
like
not
Han
Harrison
Solo?
Ford. No, he kind of doesn't look like Harrison Ford.
All right.
So, but then they got Donald Glover being like young Lando, so that could be fun.
Right. Well, you know what's weird to me is that so Poe, right?
Uh-huh.
Poe Dameron, what was he in? Rogue One?
He was in Force Awakens.
Force Awakens.
Yeah.
So that actor.
Right. Oscar Isaac.
Right. That guy's got to be in his 40s, right?
Yeah.
I would have thought that they would have skewed a little younger with that guy, but they clearly.
I don't know. I mean,
I don't know.
I like that was the thing I really liked about Force Awakens was I watched it and I'm like, I don't know if I loved it. But I want to see more adventures with these characters.
Yeah.
And that was the takeaway for that. Well, like, all right, I'm in for two more.
Yeah.
You know, let's see.
Yeah.
I mean, they might colossally screw up the eighth one.
Yeah.
But I hope not. You
right.
know, so.
Could be whatever it is.
It could be another Attack of the Clones for all we know.
Well, we can only hope.
Yeah, all right.
Scott Rogers, it has been 1 hour.
Yeah, oh my gosh. Where did it
course.
Go?
Where did it go? Of course it went away. But hey, Rangers, you know the rules. Let's do, it's at Mighty Bedbug. is Scott Rogers' Twitter feed. Yep. And then there's a Facebook fan page for Rockets, Ray Guns and Rocket Ships.
Yep.
And you have a blog spot.
I do. It's rayguns and rocketships.blogspot.com, or just put in Ray Guns Rocket Ships game and you'll find it. No problem.
And you can go to IDW Games and look around as well,
they
right?
have stuff as well.
And that's super fun. This has been fascinating. I'm excited to play Ray Guns and Rocket Ships.
Or we could just break out the Star Wars action figures and play here on the floor.
It's true. That's always good times. And all right. We'll do this again.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being on the show. And you remember what I just said? You know the rules out there? Yeah.
Take care of each other. Oh, take care of each other, too.
Yeah.
My hat, my hat, my hat. They're dancing around my hat. My hat, my hat, my hat. Well, what do you think of that? If it looks like a Mexican hat dance and it sounds like a Mexican hat dance, it's most likely a Mexican hat dance. So take off your hat and let's dance.
Yay! Oh, my God. Why don't we just call that as the end of the show?